Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Look at 1 Samuel chapter 8. That is 1 Samuel chapter 8. Glory to God. Today, we're going to be ministering on Will You Have a King? Everybody say, Will I Have a King? Youth Church is in the second half over there, guys, if you're not really sure where to go. Hallelujah. Will You Have a King? We'll be reading the entire 8th chapter of 1 Samuel. Glory to God. And, you know, Israel, it amazes me how people can serve the Lord, love the Lord, get all connected to God, and then all of a sudden, something comes along, and next thing you know, they're all, I got to have this, or I got to have that, or we got to have this to be able to serve God. You know, I remember the day that we had somebody who couldn't play the piano well, somebody who couldn't sing well, lead worship, and everybody got blessed. Amen. Amen. I remember the day that you did it without a speaker system, you know, and when they finally put a speaker system in, it was so bad, you'd rather than just turn the thing off. I mean, it cracked and popped and sizzled, and you had the little Radio Shack microphone on. You thought, boy, you had arrived with a 40-foot cable on the end of it. Hallelujah. Now, some of you all remember Shambot preaching with a wired mic, and he used to take it, he'd loop it up through his belt loop, and he'd be coming up here like that so it wouldn't pull on him all the time, because preachers get to going, they don't like to have a microphone, you know. We always said we felt like a dog on a leash. Wireless was a blessing. Amen. But, you know, and technology's great, and we love technology. But at the same time, we have to have a focus in life that supersedes everything else. Amen. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 8. And it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel. Now the name of his firstborn was Joel. The name of his second was Abiah. And they were judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, took bribes, and perverted judgment. Let me say something here. One of the things that we see with moves of God is sometimes the second or the third generation loses their focus. They get so used to it, they forget the price that was paid. Now, you got preachers running around right now who preach prosperity. I believe in prosperity. I believe in biblical prosperity. You know, and you need to take care of me like I'm Jesus walking on water. And, you know, I want my airfare covered. I want my hotel covered. I want my meals covered. I want an offering every service. I want to sell my tapes and my books and my T-shirts. And I want you to ship the stuff to the next church for me via UPS next day delivery because I need it when I get there. Come on now. Hello. And they forget, and they say, well, Dad taught prosperity. Well, you know, you go listen to Brother Hagin. He taught prosperity while he was driving a car. He couldn't drive during the day because the tires were so bald, and they were the old tires. They'd blow up from the heat. Hello. He finally sold his car. He couldn't make the payments on his car, and it wasn't worth anything. He sold it for junk. It was worth more as junk than he was selling it. And then he started taking the bus. He's still preaching prosperity. He's still preaching that Jesus wants to meet your needs. There's a lot of people who want all the benefits of something without paying a price anywhere along the lines. Amen. And let me say this. The price is never greater than the glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, and if you go back and listen to Brother Hagin's old tapes and stuff, and not just listen to the ones you like. Right. You know, you can have what you say. Oh, yeah, praise God, I can have what I say. They don't listen to all of it. Then I'll listen to part number one. You can't have anything you say. Right. Right. I can tell you right now, you can't have my wife. I'll hurt you. Amen. You can confess it if you want to. I knew one preacher, a guy hit up on his wife, and he went to the Lord in prayer and said, Lord, I know your word says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay, but I want you to know, I got this one. Hallelujah, I got this one. You don't even need to bother. I got it. I'm with him. Amen. Now, you can have what you say, what the Bible promises you. Amen. What the Word of God declares. Amen. What you by faith. And you can't have faith for something the Bible doesn't promise you. Right. Why? Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You can speak it all the time. You can declare all you want to. But if it's not a Bible promise, you don't have any basis to stand on. Right. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Where was I here? We were just getting off here. Oh, so we're talking about the second, third generation. Sometimes we lose sight of it. I'll tell you, those old Pentecostals who paid a price to be Pentecostal. Right. I heard the stories. You know, I grew up Pentecostal. And used to go to the altar every Wednesday night. You'd have those old saints. How old were they? 2 days older than dirt. But they had been in early Pentecost. And they'd come lay hands on you and pray over you. Oh, God! And you, oh, God. Yeah, that's, I'm not ready to get saved yet, you know. Oh, yeah. And just, I mean, they just, heaven come down on you. Amen. All right? But they used to tar and feather Pentecostals. If you were a Pentecostal, the other denominations, they'd gather you up and they'd run you out of town. They put tar and actually feather you and run you out of town. Because they didn't want any of that tongues business in their city. They paid a price. Well, the next generation comes along and speaking tongues is almost a game. It's a holy event in your life. You're communing spirit to spirit with the Father of spirits. Hallelujah. It's not something you play with. It's something that is a manifestation of God in your life. That is something God has endowed into your life by being baptized in the Holy Ghost, where you can commune with Him in a realm that the enemy can't get into. Right. Oh my. Hallelujah. It's holy. Amen. Hello? Amen. You know, I remember one time they asked Bruce Lee, the Green Hornet asked Bruce Lee something in one of the shows. Oh, take care of Batman and Robin. It was a mixed show. Don't hurt him. And Bruce Lee said, Gung Fu is Gung Fu. It's no child's play. The things of God are the things of God. They are not child's play. We need to be holy. We need to reverence Him. You don't have to be weird, but you need to have reverence for the things of God. Amen. They're precious. Amen. And you can grieve the Holy Ghost, and He'll flutter away and won't even show up, and you won't even know He's gone. Amen. They walk not after His ways, but turn aside after lucre. Money always gets in there, doesn't it? After bribes and perverted judgment. If you feared God, you wouldn't do that. People who fear God don't get greedy for filthy lucre. There are people selling their souls right now at the altar of political correctness. Now, listen, forget about the world. In the church, for lucre's sake. Because they'll lose people with money. They won't take a stand on the Word of God because they'll lose that member who gives a lot of money to the church. Amen. Who's your source? Now listen, we've lost some people and our church isn't as big as it used to be, but I am telling you, we are still taken care of by God. Amen. There are months we go and we kind of go look at it and we go, how? Mm-hmm. How did we get through this month? There's no way we should have gotten through this month. And then you look at the next month and you're going, my God, there's no way we can get through that month. But God. There is a God in heaven. Hallelujah. Who looks down upon His children. Glory to God. Who has an answer to every need and every circumstance and every situation. And that no matter what, when it comes to the end of the road, He's there with the answer already. He knows what you have need of before you ask or He knows it. Before you even found out about it, He's already got the answer. I told somebody not too long ago, they were facing something. I said, hey, God knew about it before you got here. Right. Right. God already had an answer before you got here. There was already a supply set aside before you got here. Amen. What do? I just stay in faith. Amen. I keep trusting God. I keep declaring that my God is my source. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So they turned aside after lucre, briberies, and they perverted judgment. Why? Listen, they perverted judgment. People pervert the Word if it means that they're going to make gain out of it or it's going to keep them in a comfortable place. I hear people preach stuff and I think, what in the world are you thinking? Now, let me be real honest with you. We got people, I remember when North Carolina passed Amendment 8, about the, you couldn't marry homosexually, and of course the court knocked it down. Well, yeah, our courts are so loaded with such liberal justices that they, judges, that they just go, they find which one they know, and they run something in there, and they go, oh, that's unconstitutional. And once they say it's unconstitutional, there's nothing you can do about it. Unless we have a civil war, which we could be coming to if things don't change. But I know some people who were pastors who were upset for the hate speech and the hate mongering and the homophobia that we didn't want homosexuals to get married. Are you a pastor or not? Do you read your Bible or not? I feel like I'm watching Pirates of the Caribbean. Well, the code's not actually a code. It's more like guidelines. Keep to the code. Well, it's really not a code. It's guidelines. It's a code when it fits your mantra or your narrative. It's guidelines when it doesn't. And that just can't be. Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. You can't pervert judgment, mainly because of lucre and bribery. People are afraid they're going to lose people. They're going to lose income. They're going to lose money. And so they'll pervert judgment. God's word is his judgment. God don't have to come down and go, I judge you and beep. He's already judged it with his word. His word has already made a declaration. That is his judgment about the matter. Amen. Hallelujah. And so these things happen. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and called Samuel unto Ramah. Not Ramah Bible Training Center, but a different Ramah. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together. I'm sorry, they did that. We're going to do that twice. And said unto him, behold, you're old, and your sons don't walk in your ways. Now, there is a problem there. They're not walking in his ways. And he's gotten old, probably too old to do anything about it. Wore out. You can get wore out. Shouldn't. Should get renewed every day, but you can get wore out. You know, got a lot of stuff going. You can get wore down. And then his sons weren't doing right. And so they come in and say, hey, you're old. Your boys ain't doing right. What we need is a king. Yeah, that's right. We figured it all out. We need a king. Can I say something? Let God figure it out and don't you do it. Amen. What we need in this here church is we need some more liberality. Yeah, we need this kind of ministry, and we need that kind of ministry. And if I don't get it, I'm going somewhere else. Oh, so you're not here because you believe God called you here. You're here because of what you want. Yeah. Consumer gospel. There you go, son. That's a good one. Hallelujah. Now make us a king to judge us like all the other nations. Do you know some that other nations don't have in their judgment? M-E-R-C-Y, mercy. God judges with mercy. There is always mercy attached to the judgment of God. When God's judgment comes, if you will repent, mercy will be extended. In a lot of other countries and nations, you can repent and they'll cut your head off anyway. You don't want to be judged like the nations. You want God's judgment. It's just. And it always has mercy attached to it. And if you'll repent, I'm telling you, if you'll repent, God will. All right, that's all I needed. That's all I needed. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. We want to be judged like the other nations. This thing displeased Samuel, who said, when they said, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. The Lord said unto Samuel, hearken to the voice of the people. In all that they have said unto you, for they have not rejected you, they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. They wanted a different king than the king, the reign or the kingdom of God. And people start looking for others to reign over them rather than God. For one reason, God deals in absolutes. My moral code is my moral code, says the Lord. I mean, it's just what it is. It doesn't change just because we're in the 21st century or the 22nd century or the 23rd. It doesn't change just because you got people who run around can't identify with what they really are. It doesn't change just because somebody passes an ordinance that says that men can use the women's bathroom and women can use the men's bathroom. And listen, folks, it's not just the bathroom. I know someone who teaches in a public school situation, and they were instructed that if a student came and wanted to use the girls' locker room as a boy who identified as a girl, they had to accommodate them. And if the girls who were in the locker room didn't like it, they had to accommodate them with another way of taking care of it. But the person who identified as a girl got the room. It ain't just about Target's bathroom. So what high school hormonal boy isn't going to start identifying as a girl during P.E.? All of a sudden, every one of them goes, I'm a girl. Come on now. Jeff said he would have done it. Slap him. All right. Unsaved. B.C. boys, hormonal, and they get to go, I'm a girl, and go to the girls' locker room while they change clothes. Just because they said that. Nathan's on that friend zone thing. All right. Men come up with crazy stuff. Their minds, especially those who are not born again, their minds are not renewed to the things of God. As a matter of fact, the wisdom of this world is for earthly, sensual, and devilish. But the wisdom of God is peaceable, easy to be entreated. Amen? You know, but the wisdom of this world does not have God's moral code in it. It's demonic. Only a demonic mind could think that it's okay to let... Now listen, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't want women going in the locker room with little boys. Right. Well, women aren't like men. Have you read the paper the past 20 years? Mm-hmm. Which ones? It's teachers. All the teachers molesting boys are women. Mm-hmm. Hello? So the wisdom of this world is messed up. Say it's messed up. All right. Verse 8, according to all the works which I've done this day since I brought them up out of Egypt, even unto this day, wherewith they have forsaken me and served other gods, and do they also unto thee. Here we come. God's done all this for them. He delivered them out of Egypt. He kept them in the wilderness. He's done all kinds of stuff. We don't want that anymore. We want a king. Now therefore hearken unto the voice. How be it? Yet protest solemnly unto them and show them the manner of king that shall reign over them. Now, in other words, I'm going to give them what they want, but you tell them what's going to happen when they do. Now, here's how dumb people can be. You can lay it out what's going to happen as soon as you do this, and they'll go, yeah, I still want it that way. It's called stupid on steroids, or SOS. Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that asked him a king. And he said, this will be the manner of king that shall reign over you. Listen to this. Listen to what he tells them is going to happen if they get a king. All right? He'll take your sons and appoint them for himself. Now, in other words, I'm not going to keep Nathan at home. He's not going to be around my house. King's going to come get him. I don't get to see him. Now, he knows this. We get upset if we can't see him for a day. Love my buddy. Love my girls. All right? He's the baby. Don't look like a baby, does he? He'll take your sons and appoint him for himself, for his chariots, to be his horsemen, and some shall run before his chariots. He'll appoint him captains over 1,000, captains over 50s. Will set him to ear his ground, to reap his harvest, to make his instruments of war, instruments of chariots. He'll take your daughters and make them, they're going to be the bakers. They're going to make some sugar stuff. They're going to bring some donuts to the king. Hallelujah. I wonder if they were Krispy Kreme workers. All right? He'll take your daughters to be confectioners, to be cooks, to be bakers. He'll take your fields, your vineyards, your olive yards, and the best of them, and give them to his servants. He'll take the tenth of your seed and your vineyards and give to his officers and to his servants. He'll take your men servants and your maid servants and your goodliest young men and your asses and put them to work. He'll take a tenth of your sheep, and ye shall be his servants. And ye, listen, and ye shall cry out in that day because of your king, which the Lord, which ye shall have chosen unto you, and the Lord will not hear you in that day. Now stop. That does not sound like a pretty picture. No. If you get a king, this is what's going to happen. You're not going to have your kids. You're not going to have your crops. You're not going to have your animals, all that. And you're going to be serving the king. He's going to take your money. He's going to take your honey. He's going to take your kids. He's going to take your daughters. He's going to take your animals. He's going to take your land. He's going to take your vineyards. All for himself. Right. Now, you can have that if you want it. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel and said, nay, but we will have a king. Are you stupid? Are you crazy? We believe that a king will be good for us. It's like back when the president was running back in the 90s. Clinton. And they're going around saying, it's the economy, stupid. It's the economy, stupid. It's the economy, stupid. Do you know for the believer it's not the economy? Amen. The moral compass of the nation far outweighs who has, and let me say something, he didn't have the best economic stuff. You go study it out, and what really happened was he got in on the tail end of what Reaganomics started back from the 80s. It finally kicked in. And all that kicked in. And then by the time he left office, where it looked like he'd done so great, all of it started falling apart. Within a few years, all the Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac stuff just absolutely collapsed the economy. Because they were forced to loan money to people who couldn't afford to pay them back. And they knew it when they loaned them the money. But because they were loaning the money, houses were being built. And because houses were being built, jobs were being created. And because jobs were being created, money was being spent. But then when it got to where they couldn't, when it finally caught up to them, it just went. And you say, well, our economy's great now. We only have 5-something% unemployment. Go read the internals, people. That is because we have another 5 or 6% who left the workforce. They're not looking for work. We have the lowest post-war labor participation in history. What do you mean by labor participation? They take how many people are actually working, how many people are in the country. That's the percentage. That is labor participation. When people leave the work, well, not the population, the people who are actively looking for work. They take the number of people who are actively looking for work, people who have jobs, and that is your labor participation. When people stop looking and they are no longer on unemployment, they're just out there cutting grass, somebody nobody knows about it, or robbing banks, or stealing, or living with a relative, or whatever, their numbers are taken out of the higher number of how many people are in the market, and it lowers the unemployment. Not because unemployment went down, because people just gave up looking for work. They just quit. They got frustrated and quit. Okay? But people, I would tell people, I had Christians, I'd say, how can you vote for him? He's pro-abortion. How can you vote for him? He's, you know, they're pro-homosexual. How can you vote for them? It's the economy. Hey, Jesus does not like abortion. It's the economy. It's the economy. It's the economy. You're selling out for lucre and all that other stuff. Amen? You're giving up for all that. We can't do that. We have to be for Jesus. And we can't have a king, and we can't have stuff that we want. We can't have the things that make us happy. We have to go with what the Word teaches. All right? So here we go. Moving more. Now therefore hearken unto my voice, protest vehemently. We read all that. And then we come down to verse 19. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel. And they said, nay, but we will have a king over us, that we may be like all the nations. They want to be like everybody else. Okay? And that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles. And Samuel heard all the words of the people, and he rehearsed them in the ears of the Lord. And the people, and the Lord said to Samuel, hearken to their voice, make them a king. And Samuel said unto the men of Israel, go ye every man into a city. And they began the process of creating a king. What happens here? We have three main centers of life. Society, or people in the kingdom of God or outside the kingdom of God, their society or peer pressure centered. They respond to peer pressure. Hello? Verse 20, that they may be like all the nations. They wouldn't be like everybody else. That's peer pressure. Well, everybody drinks. Everybody smokes dope. Everybody does this. Everybody does that. No, they don't. It's just the people you're hanging out with do. And they'll use pressure on you to get you to conform to what they're doing. When the Word of God's teaching opposite, the pressure comes from the peers. And a lot of people don't want to be, what's the word I'm looking for? Don't want to be ostracized, don't want to be looked down upon, don't want to be treated badly, so they will do it just to get the pressure of their peers off of them, so they won't look like a weirdo. Oh, you're one of them. You're one of them Christians that are crazy. You're one of them Christians that don't have any sense. I just don't understand that. I mean, I go to church and I drink. There's a lot of people who go to church and have sex with people they shouldn't have sex with. There are Catholic priests who are having sex with little boys. They went to church, as far as the people, because they were to church. Come on. We don't live that way. That's not how life is. Peer pressure is of the devil. It will use all kinds of stuff from other people to force you into doing something that you would not otherwise do. If they didn't have a bunch of nations around them with a king, Israel wouldn't have been asking for a king. If the Amorites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Termites, and all those otherites didn't have a king, they wouldn't show them one day, hey, we want a king like them. Somebody say, ouch, or amen. Or help me, Jesus. So peer pressure. You can't, as a believer, you can't let peer pressure govern you. Because it will always govern you. It will always control you. Hello? You'll go out with your buddies. And then you'll start trying to justify it. Go out with your, people that you don't go to church with. Maybe it's good for your business that you go out and sit and drink wine with everybody. Because they all drink wine. And they want you to wine and dine them. Hello? And then you come along and go, we don't drink. What kind of weirdo are you? You don't drink? I mean, our communion wine is alcoholic. Come on. And so the pressure comes to conform so that people won't think you're weird. Did you know you're weird? Hello? You're born again. You're a disciple of Jesus Christ. You are not normal. Hello? The life of God's in you. You've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His dear Son. You're not normal. Amen. The Bible says, some people act like, the Amplified says, mere men. We're not mere men. The Amplified Bible says, mere unchanged men. I got born again. I became different. What do you mean? I put away the slits and the cords for Jesus. Amen. I didn't need Mad Dog 2020. I got the Holy Ghost. Amen. Got rid of MD 2020 and got Acts 2:38. Hallelujah. Are you here? I got God. I'm different. But my friends won't want to go out with me. Your life is not about having friends who pull you down. Your life is to be the light in darkness, the salt in the earth, the one who comes and takes a stand and says, you don't have to do that to have fun. You don't have to live this way to be accepted. I've been accepted by God Himself. Hallelujah. And I can have a joyful, joy-filled life. And I don't have to get high. I don't have to get drunk. I don't have to smoke dope. I don't have to be weird. I mean, like worldly weird. I don't have to have holes in my face. I can be who God made me to be. So the society-centric or the peer pressure life is not of God. It will bring you into captivity and to bondage. It's what it did for Israel. Secondly, the self-centered life. What's that? It's the all-about-me crowd. They want to go to the church that gives them everything they want. They are the seeker sensitive who doesn't want to conform or change to the image of Christ. They want the church to conform to the image of what they want to satisfy their religious need. I want to go to the church that tells me they drink wine. I want to go to the church that doesn't have any morals. I want to go to the church, and there's a husband and wife that actually did this on the internet, carried by a real news network. They discovered the way to share the love of God is to switch partners. They would go somewhere, they would switch partners, they would have sex with them, and then they would get them saved. Because they were showing love in the highest manner. That's self-centered. I said, that's self-centered. It's an abomination in the nostrils of God. But they want a church, that people want churches that give them what they want. You don't have to submit. You don't have to conform. You don't have to yield. You don't have to repent. You don't have to, it just feel good. I mean, the worship song is, if you can't be with the one you love, honey, love the one you're with. Stop singing that song. There's a road on the distant shore. Oh, stop. One of the catchiest songs you'll ever hear, one of the most anti-Christ songs you'll ever hear. Because it's amorality. You can't be with the one you love, honey. Love the one you're with. Yes, love the one you're with. Go ahead and slap him. God does not save you to a self-centered life. It is not all about you. And we treat the world like it's all about them. No, God loved them so much He sent Jesus. He sent Jesus to deliver them from the authority and kingdom of darkness, to translate them into the kingdom of His dear Son, but to make them servants of God, children of God and servants of God. They serve the Lord with all their heart. Serve Him with gladness. It is not... We went off too far in the Word of Faith charismatic circles. Because we made everything about us. God's going to make us rich. We're going to have supernatural debt cancellation. Right. You'd hear people say it. And every once in a while they throw in there, so I can bless the kingdom. But the whole time they're thinking about the three houses. Right. Hello. One over in France on the... what's the southern part of France called? Yeah, the French Riviera. And if you do it right in the corner, you can do the French and the Italian Riviera. Okay. Have your house on the mountains, you know. I mean, have all the stuff. All they can think about is having all the stuff. It's not because they want to advance the kingdom. They want to be rich. And so they listen to the prosperity message, and they don't hear the part about building the kingdom of God. They don't hear the part about, you know, that money is laid up for the Lord. They don't hear the part about building churches in overseas and supporting missionaries and all that. All they hear is, I want to get rich. That's a self-centered life. And I'll tell you, here's what I say. If next week we had a prosperity seminar here in Greensboro, and we called in all the big shots, called them all in, at the Colosseum, we would fill the Colosseum up. And people would unload untold amounts of money during the services. But if you called in people like Leonard Ravenhill and some of these guys, I don't know if he's still alive, but and had them come preach a holiness seminar, separating and consecrating and dedicating yourself to the things of God, putting off the things of the world, getting rid of worldly attitudes and worldly this, and come to, you probably wouldn't be able to get, you probably wouldn't, I know you wouldn't fill the bathroom thing up, you might not fill a bathroom up. And the money wouldn't be the same. Why? Because we've developed an all about me mentality in the church. What's in it for me? How about come and give because of what Jesus invested in you? His blood. His very life. Can you say amen? All right. I got to read this passage. How did we get this far into the service? I want to finish, but I'm not going to be able to finish. I'm only halfway done. James says a self-centered life. Verse 1 of chapter 4 through James 4, 1 through 6. From whence cometh wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lust that ye war in your members? Now the word lust in the Greek comes from a word that means to lust. Literally means strong desire. And that strong desire can be lust or right, depending on the context. So if you're lusting after the things of God, you have a strong desire for the things of God, that's positive. And usually the translators would translate it based on the context of positive or negative. Usually the word lust was used to translate it when it was referring to negative things, like catering to your flesh. Okay? But it means strong desire. Ye lust and ye have not, ye kill. You desire to have and can't obtain. You fight and war, yet you have not because you ask not. I'm down in verse 3 and 4. You have not because you ask not. Now, wait a second now. He didn't stop there. Because there's a lot of people going around asking for stuff they're not getting. Look at the next verse. Verse 3. Ye ask and receive not because you ask amiss. What does that mean? Wrongly. Why? That you may consume it upon your lust. He says, you don't ask and you don't get. And then if you are asking, you're asking wrongly because you want to consume it on your lust. That you may consume. Listen to what he says next. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? He's not talking about carnal adultery and adulteresses. He's talking about adulterating the things of God to be friends with the world. How do you know? Know you not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? It means against God. Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Folks, you cannot go around and say, it's all right for me to commit fornication because I'm under grace and God loves me. It's all right for me to get drunk. It's all right to smoke dope. It's all right to do all this because grace is on me. You become an adulterer or an adulteress with the world, become the enemy of God. That went over big. Somebody grunt. Do you think that the Scripture saith in vain, the Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? God is envious for your attention. God is envious for your whole heart. God is envious that everything you do is for Him and for His pleasure and to honor Him and to bless Him. And the Spirit of God is working in you to cause that. But he gives more grace. Listen to this. Wherefore he saith, God gives grace to the proud. It's not what he says, is it? He resisteth the proud. Well, who are the proud? Those who say they can do it their way and still get the blessings of God. Those who say they can live outside the commands and the demands of God and still get blessed. You're proud. I said, you're proud. He gives more grace. Wherefore he saith, he resists the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. Think of that. Who are the humble? Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he'll lift you up. When God tells you to do something a certain way, you humble yourself to that. You don't come up with a way out. Hello? You do it God's way. You don't get Frankie out and put on, I did it my way. Now you reword that. I did it God's way. Hello? It's got to be God's way. Let me say it this way. God's way or the highway. There's no in between. Hello? God will resist you if you do it your way. This all about me mantra that we've begun teaching in the church, that we've begun promoting in the church. We make it seeker sensitive, seeker friendly. You know, it's all about making them feel comfortable, never feeling uncomfortable. We can't ever let them feel uncomfortable. We can't ever let them feel condemned. They're going to be condemned until they get things right between them and God. Hello? One of the leading proponents of the grace message in the world, someone I know went and talked to him. And ask them, well, what do you do when you sin? I go to the Lord. Wait a second. Now that you tell everybody they don't repent. What do you do when you go to the Lord? I tell them I'm sorry. And then you stand in your pulpit week after week after week and write books after book after book and get on television show after television show after television show and tell people they don't repent. What if I do it in my culture, it'll bring people back into captivity? Yeah, but what about all people all over the world who are being brought, who are causing all kinds of troubles? All kinds of, I'm not responsible for them. I'm sorry. I said, I'm sorry. You are. If you're not, then get off of television in America. Stop selling your books here. Get off of our Christian television shows. Stop drawing money from this country and preach your message to those people you say they can't receive that other message. But you stop preaching here. Because you're causing all kinds of problems. And then you, in turn, don't even do your own preaching. Not respond. Yes, you are. The day you went on our television programs here, you became responsible. That's why. Why? Because money's at stake. Money's at stake. Next week, we're going to pick up with the Christ-centered life.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.